Three things that happen in a transition phase, because I will talk about the transitions that the body of Christ must enter into before Jesus comes. The first thing that happens when an encounter, when a transition is about to take place, or when an exodus is about to take place, is that there will be judgment. If judgment does not take place, there can be no exodus. There can be no advance, there can be no movement unless judgment takes place. And you see, the judgment of God is by two-edged sword. When God begins to judge, He brings verdicts upon the gods of this world so that they can remove their influence over the civilization in order for God to have a way to pass through. And then when God judges, He purges His church, because men must be purged to be able to receive that which is coming. Because many times when a generation is about to bow out, corruption begins to find way into the body. You know, when you start out as a generation, your only pursuit will be God. Lord, oh, you are all I seek. But when you have been in ministry for 20 years and governors begin to bow to you, senators begin to bow to you, and your influence begin to spread across Africa and Europe, a point will come where it will no longer be God alone. There will be cathedrals. There will be jets. There will be businesses. Now, nothing is wrong with these things, but these things have a way of affecting your focus. And then your focus can begin to shift from Christ to the many things that are happening. And if you are not careful, you will become engrossed with ministry that you will lose Jesus. So many times, when a generation is coming to an end of the assignment, these are the battles they fight. Their battle is no longer Pharaoh. Their battle is no longer the gods that dwell in the promised land. Their battle becomes how to manage their heart posture so that they don't miss their first love. And because that battle begins to take place, the level of focus and tenacity that is put in to build their earliest disciples, they will not have it anymore. Because the way they build their first disciples is through prayer and the word. Their first disciples, they go for fasting with them for 3 days, for 7 days. Pastor locks himself in one room, others lock themselves in another room. The way pastor is praying, that's how they pray. So usually when you look at them, the first people they train is like them. But when you follow the ladder coming down, after the seventh to the eighth dispensation, you will discover that they carry a different spirit. And at that time, because man of God is now concerned about ministry, he will think program will raise men. Programs can't raise men. No matter how many programs you have in a year, you can have programs every month. You can't raise men with programs. The way you will raise men is to carry them through the same path that God carried you through. You were not raised in a program, so you can't raise a generation by program. So many times, when a generation is ending their sojourn, the body becomes porous. And because the body becomes porous, there's a need for God to visit again. So three things will happen. The first thing that will happen is that there will be judgment. The judgment first will be against the enemy. And then secondly, it will be for the purging of the church. First, against the enemy. So when you study Exodus chapter 12 verse 12, God said, tonight I will visit Egypt and I will judge the gods of Egypt. So God came and judged Egypt and the gods of Egypt. And God killed all the first sons of Egypt. And the wealth of Egypt, God transferred it over to Israel. Because God will first of all judge. That's why I told you, we are not distracted by the violence. Because we know when God comes, the God of justice will go down. You see killing, you see persecution, you are afraid. They think they will take the church. They can't. The church is an invincible fortress. It's an invincible fortress. We are not alone. The reason is because you think men have died. They didn't die. They are called spirit of just men made perfect. And the moment you came into the church, the Bible said you have come to Mount Zion, the city of the living God, to an innumerable company of angels, to the spirit of just men made perfect. So sometimes when they want to fight us and we don't have intercessors to complete the quorum, then suddenly the intercessors of dispensation passed, because we are in Mount Zion, they will show up. Oh, you don't know that sometimes
with Enoch.
Oh, don't do. Sometimes when you come to pray, you come to church, you are alone. All the prayer band members that you persuaded to come and stand with you, they didn't come. Don't be discouraged. When you lift your hand towards heaven, that's why you will know that there have been ancient intercessors that kept the gate over just. And because your dispensation doesn't have enough intercessors, God will tell those intercessors, just needs you again. And the same way Moses came back again, Elijah came back again, warriors that walked through the land of just, many of them come back again, because we are not alone. That's why we refuse to be intimidated. We can't be distracted. When the transition happens, you will discover that one of the things that God will do is that he will judge the gods of the land. Israel was in captivity for 430 years. The problem was not Egypt. The problem was, can they transit? The day they were able to transit, God judged Egypt. The gods were judged. Their firstborn sons were taken. Their mighty men and nobles were drowned in the Red Sea. And the wealth of Egypt was transferred to Israel. So when God wants to visit, there must be judgment. That's why we declare with all boldness that the land will be won to Jesus. Amen. So when God occasions a visitation, there is a judgment for the enemy. But before we step in, the body is also purged. Because there are men that have ridiculed the heritage of God. There are men that have sabotaged sacred things, that have reduced the efficacy and the texture of our witness. Prophets that should bring the counsel of God have merchandised their graces. And so the witness of God that should secure the heritage of God have been depleted. Apostles that should preach the counsel of God and deliver a generation have created cabal systems that have short-circuited the things of God's spirit. Deliverers becoming tormentors and captors, not of the ancient world, but of the people of God. People that God raised in politics to keep the gates have gone there, and their bellies have become their gods. So before a visitation occurs, there must be circumcision at the boundary of the promised land, because God must purge his own. So one of the things that happens when there is a transition, an exodus, is that God purges his people. Second thing that happens is that God occasions restorations. And I'll tell you why. Many times the reason God occasions restoration is because the maturity level required is not there. The momentum required to leap to the next phase is not there. So while God is building and strengthening the body, there is a need for restoration to take place. And there are two things that happen when restoration is taking place before a transition. The first is the protocol, and the second is the actual restoration. Let me show you how it works. There are four things that make the protocol of restoration. The first is the mercy of God. Mercy is what God does to qualify a generation, even though there is a judgment that disqualifies them. Because in James 2:13, it says mercy prevails over judgment. That's why Paul said he was a blasphemer, an injurious man. He was not qualified to do what God has called him to do, but he said mercy found him. So when God provokes restoration, he releases mercy. Before transition takes place, there is a gate of mercy that God opens to occasion restoration, so that men who were disqualified can be accepted for the same assignment. Why transition is still pending? When you journey through mercy, God will now expose you to trials. The reason is because you took some steps and he was about to give you the authority of a businessman, so that you can become the apostle in the economic world. He was about to give you the authority in government. He was about to give you the authority to minister from the altar. You now went and fell. Mercy now spoke and judgment was eroded and you were restored, but you will not just appear where you were, because there was something God did to your soul before you came there. God will carry you through another trial. He will prove your heart for you to qualify for it, because there must be qualification. When a spirit doesn't try you, he can't empower you. That's why even Jesus himself, who is part of the Godhead, the moment he became man, he was tried. They didn't say, no, this one is part of us. So long as you are wearing this casing, a spirit must try you before he empowers you. So after mercy, there is trial. That trial is when it looks as if you enter a pit and nothing is working. And then many people want to run away. If you run away, you are finished. God will take everything away until he reset your heart. And the only thing you desire is him. When you get to that point where you desire only him, something, you are about to come to where you lost. The ground you lost have been recovered. Because the ground you lost is not terrestrial, it's in the heart. You lost so much ground in the heart. God wants to restore it, so he will allow you to go through the fire. He knows you will not be burned. He will allow you to go through the water. He knows you will not be drowned. But by all means, you must go through, so that the grounds that were lost will be restored. When that happens, then God will open the third gate, which is the gate of favor. And then all of a sudden, somebody tells somebody, have you heard about Apostle Nat? Say, which one is Apostle Nat? Don't worry, just hear this. And from one recommendation, 20 doors open. And then you say, how did it happen? You were journeying. It's restoration. It's a protocol. You move from mercy to trial, from trial to favor. When you get into favor, the whole things that you were desiring before, you don't pray for them anymore. But those things now begin to look for you. When favor comes, what happens to you is beyond what you qualify for. At that time, God has invested his credibility upon you. So when people are dealing with you, they are dealing with God. Because it is the credibility of God that now defines who you are. When you go through favor and it still doesn't alter your disposition, then God will give you the scepter. That scepter is your enthronement. That means you are qualified to command the armies of God. Anything you say is law in the spirit. They can wake you up in the morning and you were not fasting, you were not praying. And they say there is problem. You say, peace be still. Because you spoke, that same jealousy of God will go to work on your behalf. Even you will know you didn't release faith enough to handle that matter. But you have a scepter. Because he said, I, the Lord, I perform the words of my servant, and I confirm the counsel of my messengers. No matter how you were, anything you say must happen. All of those things is not transitional. They are just the packages that God does in transition to create a buffer so that the body of Christ will not drown. That's why you are seeing some people, things are happening. It's a move, it's a restoration. Because God has a bigger agenda. The bigger agenda of God is a transition. Transition doesn't affect men, it affects the body of Christ. But before the body of Christ comes into maturity to transit, there are certain men that God needs to create some complex spiritual algorithm around their life to be able to contend with the things happening territorially. The second part of restoration is the actual restoration, and two things happen. The first thing that happens in restoration is that God gives you speed. You may just come somewhere and pray for one barren person, or you pray for one cripple and that cripple is healed. And the day that crippled person was healed, the owner of TBN was there. And then now say, no, this kind of man should be on TBN. And then they put you on TBN. And then in one week, 2 million people reach out to you. Out of the 2 million people, maybe 3 will give you land. I said, please take this man. And then people will sow seed into your account until the bank will say, wait, who are you? They will frozen your account and say, who are you? Now, in that same 2 months, your followership online have grown from 100 to 2 million. You will now tell the bank, Google my name. I don't need to come. Google.
It's called speed.
Because in that 1 month, God has changed your story. It's called speed. You will now discover that the things that took your friends 5 years that would have disqualified you because of jealousy was not necessary. That's why if people are prospering, pray for them to prosper more. Because their prosperity does not stop growing. You see somebody, you say he's doing well. In the last 5 years, everybody's about him. Wait. What will happen to you in 1 week can be greater than what happened to somebody in 5 years. But if you don't know restoration, you will waste the years of your Kairos moment by being jealous of that person, and you will disqualify yourself and exonerate yourself from restoration. Even if your younger brother is prospering, thank God for his life, support him, because it doesn't stop your prosperity. And when you are supporting, don't hope he will support you. Don't hope he will remember. Forget it. Because after Joseph interpreted the dream of the butler, he forgot it. But when the day of restoration came, he said, until the time that his word came, the word of the Lord tried him. The king sent for to lose him, even the ruler of the people. He made him lord of his substance and ruler of his household, to bind his princes at his pleasure and to teach his senators wisdom. In one day, he became the second in command in Egypt. The same Potiphar that he was the houseboy in his house, we call him Lord. He said the hand of God came upon Elijah. He outran the chariots of Ahab, even unto Jezreel. It's called restoration. If restoration doesn't take the channel of speed, there's another channel it takes. It's the realignment of your season. He said the year the caterpillar worm have eaten, the year the palmer worm have eaten, the year, all the years that you lost, a spiritual manipulation will take place, and things that should happen once in 2 years, all of it will happen in 1 week. So you are no longer the one moving fast. Your seasons begin to move fast. So God puts a speed. Maybe in your spiritual season, certain things happen to you every three years. When restoration comes, God will get those things to happen to you 3 times in 1 week or in 1 month. So what it means is that you walked in 9 years in 1 month, because your seasons were manipulated. It should have taken you 10 years to be able to meet a man that will change your life. And God creates a manipulation. And in 1 week, somebody meets somebody that talks to somebody that talks to another person. And this is your helper. The things that he should do 9 years' time, he now does it now. He doesn't know why. Seasons have changed. Years that were eaten up have been restored. All of this happens in the midst of transition. The third thing that happened during transition is the qualification. The first is judgment. The second is restoration. The third is the protocol of qualification. The army that God will use, three things that happen to them. The first thing that happened to them is they begin to have encounters. Please don't be deceived. There's nobody doing anything great today that didn't have an encounter that makes it happen. The fathers of old that left, there were encounters they had that empower them to do what they are doing. You remember Bishop Oedeku said he had an 18 hours vision. In 1986, he went for a Kenneth Hagin's meeting, and suddenly he saw the face of Kenneth Hagin change to a face of a child, and oil was dripping, and he fell down and he was weeping. And God told him, this thing happening to him, I've moved it to you. So he's the second generation of the Hagin's movement. It's a faith movement. There were many people in America, but he had an encounter with Hagin, and the Hagin's kind of encounter, to be able to wear the mantle that Hagin wore. If there are certain encounters that if you don't have, you can't wear the mantles of the men that have moved. They have drunken one 79 million souls in 79 years. It's not natural evangelism that does that. There is a mantle. And for you to wield that mantle, you must have a bonkers kind of encounter. That's why for John to walk in the altar of Elijah, he had the Elijah kind of encounter. But you see, the thing with encounter is that encounters operate at an energy level. That's why when transition is about to take place, you see prayer movements begin. The prayer movement is not just about repentance. No. Repentance is part of it. But encounters take place on mountains. And mountains are energy levels in the spirit. If you're praying, you're fasting, your meditation, and your spiritual exercise doesn't bring you to Horeb, you can't see the bush burning that is not consumed. So all of the activities are not about the activities in themselves. When a generation is about to transit, there are encounters that are awaiting them. So in Songs of Solomon chapter 4 verse 4, the Bible spoke about men that pulled off mantles. They don't take mantles to heaven because you don't need it there. But before they go, there is a place called the Tower of David. That's where God keeps the mantles of warriors. So when one warrior departs, when he passes through the Tower of David, he will drop his mantle. They say the neck is like the Tower of David, builded for an armory. He said, whereof hang 1,000 bucklers and shields of mighty men. So when a mighty man leaves the world, there is a mantle that Yongicho carried that made him arrest the nation and brought them at the feet of the cross. Now that he has gone to heaven, it's not with his family. It's on the Tower of David. He's the man who can ascend to the energy level where Yongicho stood before that garment came on him, that will wear that garment. And that man may not even be in South Korea. That man may be in Congo. That man may be in Kenya. But in the spirit, that place of encounter is an energy level. If the man ascends there, that mantle will find him. And suddenly, you will see another order of the Jews. The men that have the power to see the whole nation as a church congregation. Because a mantle wields that dimension. They were prepared for the encounter. You could be in the bloodline and have it. Because God does not, you know, our generation is so wicked. They believe that sons of men of God should not inherit what they carry. It's wickedness. Because if another man's son should inherit it, why do you exonerate this person? Is it a crime that is the son of the Jew? So there is nothing wrong in Jew's children taking over their father's ministries and mantles. There is nothing wrong with it. If God qualifies them in the spirit, because if you think something is wrong with it, then you are wicked. Because you have judged them unfairly. They didn't commit a crime being the sons of those people. So they are equally qualified like every other person. But the person the man to rest on have no regard for bloodline. It only has regard for the degree to which you can press and the height you can get to in the spirit. Because when that mantle comes, there is a place where that mantle meets men. And when you get there, the mantle will alight upon you. So when God wants to occasion a transition, there are encounters that he engenders. Now, our praying, fasting, and spiritual engagement is to prepare us for that encounter. Hope you know that David's brother were already at the battlefield. But they didn't have the encounters that David had. Because when God energized David and taught his hand to fight and his fingers to war, the brothers were fighting over family birthright, lands and properties. So they were in the army when Goliath charged at Israel. That was when they realized, listen, the sister, it takes an encounter to command the army of God. It's not who first entered the army, it's who had the right encounter. David did not even have an army uniform. When Saul looked at him and gave him his garment, it was now obvious that the uniform and the badge of the spirit is different from the one men give. Men can give you a badge because you preach loud.
They can give you a bar because you preach fast. They can give you a bar because you preach mystery. But it is the encounter you have that will determine the gate that you will man. That's the gate. That is why when we come for meeting, we don't wait for anybody to motivate us. Sometimes when I go for prayer meeting and they are raising too many prayer points, I ignore them. Because the person leading the prayer has become a distraction. I go and face the wall and I'm praying. Because you don't need too many prayer points. Sometimes when you want to ascend, you need to enter a cruise mode. And it may take 40 minutes. It may take 1 hour. It may take 2 hours. It may take 3 hours before your spirit comes alive. Because when you go there, there is a place called the altar of incense, where the sounds of God begin to flow out of your spirit. It will take time of journeying, because the high priest doesn't just appear before the altar of incense. He travels from the gate to the altar of sacrifice, to the laver, to the altar of shewbread, to the menorah, before he comes there. So sometimes you are praying, the word of God is beginning to come alive in your spirit. They now truncate it from the altar. You will leave the person leading the prayer. Let him continue his show. You are doing business in deep waters, and your spirit is about to open.
Blessed by the message you just listened to and wish to make Jesus your Lord and personal Savior, kindly repeat this prayer after me. Dear Heavenly Father, I believe in your Son, Jesus Christ, and that he died for my sins and was raised from the dead for my justification. I therefore confess with my mouth that Jesus is the Lord of my life. I receive eternal life into my spirit. I am born again. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. If you just said this prayer, please send us an email on anydiscipleship@gmail.com or reach us on our website oraclemichael.com to enable us to reach you and afford us the privilege to disciple you. God bless you.